This is a short lecture on how to measure the strength of a relation between variables. But before we go into the details, we'll look at first the different type of variables you might have. In research, you might have numerical or categorical. This is a good way to classify variables. If it's numerical variables, they could be continuous, which means they could take any value, even fractions, within a range. So if you think of yield, which can be 2.75 or whole numbers like 3 tons per hectare, biomass, which can be fractions as well, height, weight, many of the variables we deal with in science are continuous variables. But there are also discrete variables, which are counts. So this could be the number of cars, the number of people in a household, number of trees, number of fish, and so on. When we look at categorical variables, they also can be classified into two major types. One is ordinal, and the other one is nominal. An ordinal categorical variable is where the different groups have an order. So if we look at soil type and we think of fertility, we could have, say, two or more groups. Let's say we have two groups. One is poor, one is fertile. Then there is an order. Poor soils have a lower fertility than fertile. Effort type could be low, medium, high, anything we can classify into levels, where the levels mean high and lower or higher and lower. That's an ordinal variable. Now, when you look at nominal values, these are things like gender, religion. The labels do not, or the groups do not, imply that one group is higher or lower in any sense than another. So they are simply classifications into different categories. You could name them, order them any way you want. They are called nominal, and they are just categories, nothing else. We might also need to pay attention to the number of variables we have. Obviously, if we have one variable, we cannot be talking about correlations or relationship between data sets. It's just a single variable. So someone could have measured the canola yield in a district and they have observations on canola yield. Well, in that case, what could they do? Well, they could still summarize the data, look at how variable it is, how high it is on average, and they could look at if it's skewed in any way and what the shape of the distribution is. So you could do histograms, box plots. You could do hypothesis testing to see if the yield in the district is equal to the known yield, a number, which could be 1.5 or 1.2 tons per hectare in the next district. But you only have one variable to work with, and this is a univariate case. In the current discussion, we are not interested in that. We are interested in cases where we have two or more variables, a bivariate case or multivariate case, and we want to look at if there are relationships between variables. So when we have two or more variables, we are interested in knowing if the variables are related. Why is this? Well, science is about relationships between variables, because all aspects of science are interested in explaining some aspect of reality, and that explanation in many forms takes the form of a relationship between a variable and another one. For agronomy, for example, you are looking at a bunch of variables or one variable and trying to explain what your crop output or yield would be and so on. Now, if we are looking at data relationships, there are different things we could do. For now, for today, we are interested in looking at a pairwise two variables at a time correlation. This is what we'll do, but later we'll look at something a bit more general called regression analysis, where you can explain a variable of interest. This could be yield, biomass, or anything else that you think is affected by one or more variables, and use a regression. So that's what we'll do at the end of the unit. But for now, we'll look at two variables at a time, and we'll look at correlation. With correlation, if you find correlation between two variables, does that necessarily mean you have a cause and effect relationship? Well, not necessarily. Because if two variables are related, they could be related because one is the cause of the other. But in some cases, that's not the case. So you don't have a causal, but you have a non-causal relationship. But even then, it means that you are interested in knowing if the two variables are related. Why is that? Because if they are, you can still use the information on one variable to predict the other. So still you could benefit from knowing how strongly correlated they are. Now, how do we measure the level or the strength of a relationship between two variables? Before we go on to numerical measures, it's good to look at simple ways of exploring the data. And those simple ways of exploring the data are to use graphical techniques, and in this case, scatter plots. A scatter plot is a plot where you have one variable on one side and the other axis. And then you can try to see if you plot the observations, what type of a pattern, if there is any, you get, okay? Or whether you just get a cloud of data where there is no clear pattern. Scatter plots are always useful when you start out and explore your data. And the things you can learn from scatter plots are whether the relationship exists and if it's strong or weak, if it's positive or negative, if it's linear or nonlinear. And this is key because when you do the scatter plot, you will see whether the relationship between two variables is linear or not. You might also be able to spot outliers, which means observations that do not follow the pattern followed by most of the other observations. And you might also be able to spot or see if there are clusters. So separate groupings, meaning that there isn't a simple pattern applying to the whole sample. And subsamples might have different types of relationships between the two variables. Now, quickly, if I see something like this, what should I say about the strength of the relationship? So it's not a perfect line, but there is a strong pattern, and the pattern is very tight. So if I know one of the variables, like x being 0.4, then I know y is somewhere in here. And if x is 0.8, y is somewhere in here. So that range for y, meaning my ability to predict the value of y, once I know x, y is here, is good. And this is why we say there is a strong relationship between x and y. X is a good predictor of y. Now, if I go to something that looks like what you see here, what do I say? Well, can I use x to predict y? Well, when we look here, what we see is this is nonlinear, but again, it's very tight. So once I know the value of x, if x is 0.2, then I know y is in here. And if x is 0.5 in here, I can know that y is somewhere in here. And if x is 0.8, I know y is in here. So it's a consistent pattern. So that's why I say this is a strong relationship, but it is not linear. It's nonlinear because over a certain range, when x increases up to 0.5, y is going up, but beyond that, when x increases, y is going down. So it's nonlinear. The effect of x on y is not always positive. It's positive initially, and then it dies out and becomes negative. So think of, for example, water and yield. And if you don't have enough water, your yield will increase. But if you keep applying water, the value of extra water diminishes. So it's not going straight this way, okay? It is leveling off. And then if you apply too much water, it will die off. You are going to waterlog, cause waterlogging and kill off the plants. So this is a non-linear relationship, and in nature you should always allow for such type of relationships and not assume that things are simple. Now, what happens if I get something like this? The first difference between this one and the very first plot we saw is that the pattern is not as consistent, but still there is a clear indication that the value of x can help you predict y. They are positively relative in this case. But the range, your capacity to predict y based on the value of x is weaker because there is any number of values, a wider set of values that y could take for any given value of x. So that's why we could classify this as weak. Now, this is all visual, and the measures we are using, weak, strong, and so on, are qualitative measures. They are not quantitative measures. we will look at what quantitative measures are when we go to the correlation coefficient. In this case, we have something similar to the very first one. There is a tight pattern. So we can predict fairly well what y would be based on the value of x. So we could say this is a negative one, but it's strong negative relationship. Now, in this case, what we have is clusters. So this is a well-known dataset called IRIS dataset. It comes with the R software. So if you upload it using the data command, you will see that it has got 150 rows and it's data for three species. And the three species are colored here differently with red, blue, and green. And if you look at the relationship between sepal lengths and sepal widths, and if you ignore the fact that there are three different species or that there are different clusters, you might conclude that there is no relationship between sepal length and widths. Because if I had colored this in one color, maybe I would settle for a pattern that looks like this. And in that case, I might say there is a weak negative relationship between sepal length and widths, but that's misleading. It's misleading because if we look at one species at a time, we can see there is a stronger pattern, and that pattern is not negative, it's positive. So the bigger the sepal length, the bigger the sepal widths. So this is a good example of why when you look at some samples, you need to be careful if there are different subsamples in the dataset or if there are clusters. And doing plots and using colors to plot subsamples very easily in R is a very good way of spotting this type of cases where you need to be careful not to lump different relationships into one general relationship, which might be very weak. We have looked at how to use scatter plots to help us explore the data and see if there is a relationship between two variables and if that relationship is positive or negative, if it's strong or weak. If there are clusters, we can also use it to see if there are outliers and so on. Now, if we want to go a bit further and use a numerical measure, we need to look at the correlation coefficient, or what's commonly known as rho. What does the correlation coefficient measure? Well, it is an indication or a measure of the strength of a relationship between two variables. And specifically, it's a measure of the strength of a linear relationship between two variables. What else can we say? It's a numerical summary, so it's one number. What else? It's a unitless measure, meaning it has no units. Rho is just a number. Okay, if you look at yield, height, weight, and so on, they have units, kilograms, tons per hectare, inches or centimeters, kilograms or pounds, and so on. The correlation coefficient has no units. And it doesn't matter how you measure your two variables, it's not going to be affected by whether you are using inches or centimeters or pounds or kilograms. It's always going to give you the same result, which is good because you don't want to get different stories by changing units. And it's also a standardized measure, always taking values within the range of minus one to one. So if the relationship is very strong, it's going to be numerically big. So it means it's going to be closer to one or minus one. If it's negative, it's closer to minus one. If it's positive, it's closer to one. The correlation coefficient is also known as the Pearson's correlation coefficient. The reason we have to mention this is because when you look at R, there are methods, and the method had a default value of the Pearson correlation coefficient. Whereas if you want to change it to some other type of coefficient, as we'll see later, you need to tweak that argument. But it's a default case is what we are discussing here, so you don't need to change that. It's always Pearson. Now, how do we calculate it? Well, before we can manage to calculate the correlation coefficient, I need to mention there are different ways. The different intermediate values that you might need to calculate the correlation coefficient could be things like standard deviations for your x values or y values. They could be z-scores or standardized values of your variables. I will mention what these are. This is simply you take your x and y values and convert them into standardized units. Z scores, we'll come back to that one. You could also use the covariance. So depending on what formula you need, you might need to calculate the standard deviations and the covariance, or you might need just this Z scores to measure the correlation coefficient. There are other ways as well, but we'll go for the shorter ones. So the shorter ones are, you can measure the correlation coefficient, one, as a ratio of the covariance of the two variables, two, the product of their standard deviations, Sx is the standard deviation of x, Sy is the standard deviation of y, S sub xy is the covariance, so what you are doing here is covariance of xy over the standard deviation of x times the standard deviation of y. Now, if you do that, that's a very easy way to calculate the correlation coefficient. All you need to do is calculate the covariance in the standard deviations. Now, that's the first and easy way. The other one is, if you have z-scores, you could calculate the correlation coefficient by simply taking the cross product of the z-scores for x and y, summing them up, dividing by one less the sample size. This is, again, a simple way to calculate the correlation coefficient and can be done by hand if the samples are small. Now, you can also use this bigger formula. These are all equal. So you can go from here into here or into here or the other way. We won't bother about the calculations, but if you're doing stats in the Department of Statistics, that might be something that you do for your assignment. For us, it's not necessary. Just to know that they are all doing the same calculation, and we tend to prefer the simpler ones if we want to do it by hand. Now, what does it mean to do it by hand? Well, first, let me tell you, you want to do this by hand, because you are using R in this case, and we'll have a method just for it. But for now, let's say you were working in Excel, you had two variables, and your sample had a size of four, so you had four observations in your sample, and X took those values, and the corresponding values for Y were as shown here. Now, if you wanted to calculate the correlation coefficient using the formula, which says the correlation coefficient is the covariance divided by the ratio of the standard deviations, what you do is you need to calculate the covariance and the standard deviations. But in Excel, you can do that very easily. You can use the standard deviation command, calculate standard deviations, and you can use the covariance, sample covariance command. And what you find is the correlation coefficient is now, because the covariance is 7.5, it is 7.5 divided by 3.1, just taking rough numbers, times 2.6. And that's going to give you a correlation coefficient of 0.91, roughly. So the correlation coefficient between the two variables shown here is 0.91. Now, what does that mean? It means it's positive because it's a positive correlation coefficient. So when x goes up, y tends to go up. It is strong because it's close to 1, which is the number for perfect positive correlation. Now, this is if you use the covariance and the standard deviations to calculate. But if you want to use the other formula, which is the middle one, the one shown here, what you need to do is first you need to calculate the z-scores or the standardized values. Well, how do you do that? The z-score is measured as the x value minus the sample mean divided by the standard deviation. So in this case, it's 4 minus 5.5, which is minus 1.5, divided by 3.1. Roughly, that's about a half, minus half. So that's what you see is about here, about minus half. You keep doing the same thing for all the x values, subtract the mean, divide by the standard deviation, and you get the score. Now, you do the same thing for y and get these z scores. The next step is to multiply the z scores and get the cross products. Then once you have those, you can sum them and divide them by sample size less one. In this case, sample size is n is equal to 4. So you divide them by 3, and then that means 2.75 divided by 3 is going to give you the correlation coefficient of 0.91 or 0.92. In fact, I should have rounded it to 0.92. And that's your correlation coefficient. That's how you'd calculate it in Excel. In R, you can calculate the correlation coefficient using the method called cor, and you just pass the names of the two variables, and then it will give you the correlation coefficient. There is a method argument in that cor function, but you don't need to change it because the default is a Pearson. So if we use the raw values, obviously, if you have a perfect relationship, you will always get a value of 1 for rho if it's positive relationship and minus 1 for rho if it's negative. Now, why do we need this calculation? It's to give you an idea of what correlation coefficient you would get for something that looks like what's plotted here. So this is not a very tight distribution, but it's also a very consistent pattern. Some people would say this is a strong relationship and you get a correlation coefficient of 0.7. If we look at the opposite case, obviously, in this case, you'll get a minus one because it's perfect and negative. In this one, you will get, again, something that's in the 60s, around 70. But in most real data sets, things are not going to be this consistent. Unless you have experimental data where you control for a lot of things, you will find scatter plots where things are less consistent and you might have outliers in the data set. So your correlation coefficients could be low. But the purpose here is to give you an idea of the relationship between the scatter plot patterns and the size of the raw coefficient. Finally, what we need to always remember is if we have nonlinear relationships, the correlation coefficient is not designed for that. It's for linear ones, and it can be very misleading if you just apply, ignoring that the x and y values, I should have written y here, are related, but in a nonlinear way. Now, this makes it clear why. In here, in both cases, we have perfect nonlinear relationships, but what do we get? What we get is low numerical values for our row. And if you look at the row value, you would be misled and you would think there is very little relationship between the variables. And this is a good example why when you read data sets, you need to look at them, which means you need to use graphics to explore your data, like scatter plots and so on. Because if you read the data set, you didn't do these plots and you just calculated the raw value and you got these numbers, you could be drawing a misleading conclusion from your analysis. So always look at your data. Now, so far we have looked at correlation coefficient for two variables. We didn't say much about when we cannot use a correlation coefficient other than at the very beginning describing what different data sets we have. Now, obviously the correlation coefficient is good for numerical data, but if we have categorical data, we cannot apply it because categorical variables in this case are just categories. They are not numbers, they are not quantities. So for example, if we have data on how gender affects or is related to brand choice, what we need to do is find some other way. And that other way is maybe try cross-tabulation. For example, we could cross-tabulate gender by brand choice and observe what we see here. And in this case, what do we see? Well, we see that the pattern is going this way. So females tend to prefer brand A and males tend to prefer brand B. Of course, we could do this in R very easily as well using the table command. All you have to do is give it the names of the two variables and it will give you a cross-tabulation. In fact, this can be done also by groups for a third variable, but let's not get entangled in that. So the main message is if you have categorical variables, you will need to use cross-tabulation and see if there are patterns. Of course, the numbers you use in this cross-tabulation could also be proportions. So that's for data relationships and correlations. Stop the lecture here.